What up? It's your boy PA, and I got my boy with me.
So this Manny,
and we are Cafe Moto Podcast, baby.
Episode one.
So we'll get right into it. So who are you, sir?
My name is Manny. A motorsports enthusiast. I'm in the industry, motorcycle specifically, and just ready to talk. I don't know.
As I said before, PA in the all industries, I guess you could say, aircraft, motorcycle, automotive in general. Mm-hmm. So, what are you currently building?
Right now, I'm building a 1977 XS750D, which, if you don't know, that's the Yamaha's first triple that they built. So hoping to get that up and running by the end of the year. Taking my time with it, and I'm out of garage right now, but making it work.
Yeah, can't rush perfection.
That's right.
And then also, what are you trying to get out of this podcast? What are we trying to do?
I'm just trying to grow my influence, grow the business that I run. I have a business right now called Run It. It's going to be motorsports themed apparel and a few different little merchandise products, I guess. So I'm trying to really expand all that and hopefully get some good ideas, meet some new people, and really really see how far I can push this and how many, see if I can get more builds and more cars, more bikes under my belt. You know how it goes.
Oh, yeah, I know that all too well. I guess it'll be my turn then.
Yeah, so what cars are you building?
So I've got a 70 Monte Carlo that currently building a 355 for it, going EFI with Asus fuel injection. And
heard great things.
Well, yeah, Asus EFI with that, and it'll essentially be a, unbeknownst to me, it's going to end up being an all Edelbrock build. Mm. I don't know how I ended up with all Edelbrock parts, but I got Edelbrock heads, aluminum heads. You got a Comp Cams, Big Mother Thumper Cam, which essentially is a subsidiary of Edelbrock, I found out. Mm. Or I guess they're like all in one thing.
Under one house, yeah.
Yeah. So big cam in there. And it is bore 30 over, so make it a 355. And yeah, so building that, just got finished with a Mazda RX-8 for $300. Oh, wrapped that and everything and sold that pretty quick, but built that. And then bike wise, 77 Suzuki GS750. Mm-hmm. That your boy Mo painted.
Yes, sir.
That tank is beautiful. I got a whole bunch of likes on it.
Yeah.
When I went to the local Cards and Coffee.
No, yeah, Mo kills it. He's a great painter.
Oh, yeah.
Mo Colors from Tampa, if you're looking. Mo Colors. Yes, sir.
And then the bike that kind of, well, that one didn't start at all. My 79 XS750 started it all, technically. Mm-hmm. But the bike that I've like went ground up on, 83 XJ750. Yep. Making a bobber out of that.
Yep. That one's coming out nice too.
Yeah. And then there's a car coming. Mm-hmm. There's a car coming. It ain't here yet, but there's a car coming.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You're not going to let anybody know until you get it, or what? Is it under wraps right now? I know what it is.
Yeah, I'm about to say a few people know what it is, but for the most part, it's under wraps because I don't want to jinx it at the same time because, like, something stupid may happen. It's just like, well.
No, yeah, for real.
I no longer have this now. It may fall off the back of the U-Haul or something when I come back. Hopefully it doesn't. Knock on wood, but. Anything can happen. So until it's in the garage or until it's in the driveway, because I ain't got no garage space, then I'll talk about it.
Yes, sir. I can't wait for that. We got to do some rollers and some videos on that.
I can't wait for that, too. Yeah. Only spoiler I'll give is it's turbo.
Dang.
It's a factory turbo car. So that's about it.
Yes, sir.
And then kind of with you wanting to grow the following, share the business, which if I didn't say it before, I own the Shop Collective, and it's primarily vapor honing, but I mean, realistically, anything vintage or anything that needs vapor honing, which usually is things that are vintage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's what I work on. But yeah.
So what's vapor honing for people who don't really know? Because I know
I'm glad you asked.
It's I got
I'm glad you asked,
no,
brother.
I know I've met a lot of people even who work on cars daily who still really don't know what vapor honing is. So
yeah, so vapor honing, for those that don't know, is the easiest way I tell people is like, think about sandblasting, and then like it's 10 times better.
Mm-hmm.
But it's essentially wet blasting. So, you know, you got your media, which is glass bead, it could be silica, it could be aluminum oxide. There's a bunch of different medias, but the main two that I use is glass bead and aluminum oxide.
Mm.
And you got your air, and then you got water. And the water cushions the abrasive, so it's not as impactful onto your part. So with sandblasting, you're essentially beating the hell out of it with sand and air, just pulverizing all the dirt and all that stuff off,
mm-hmm.
which is great because you get it's clean, but you touch it with your fingers or anything oily, it just like soaks right back into it.
Yep.
Vapor honing, because it's essentially hitting the surface and like bouncing off, like almost like a microfiber rubber band ball or mm-hmm. something like that. You know, it just hits it, takes the dirt off, and then bounces right back off. And you know, of course, you keep the cycle going and it with the air, and it knocks the stuff off and it leaves a shine. With the glass bead, that's what gives it the polish. Mm-hmm. The aluminum oxide is what actually takes the dirt and stuff like that off.
Right.
So I've done as big recently as a oil pan, at least wide width wise I've done an oil pan for a killer R34. I think his name is the Sandwich Artist. Killer R34, man.
One of my dream cars.
Yeah. He's got two. He's got two of them.
Love the 32s.
So yeah, done that. And then I've done BMW wheels, 18-inch wheels, which for those that don't know, BMW mainly does staggered.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was like an 18x8.5 and an 18x10, I want to say. For the rear wheels, I've done those as well, and like kind of everything in between.
Yeah, you did my carbs and they came out insanely good.
Boy,
so good.
I will say the people that keep me the most employed though are FD owners for reasons that are obvious, but yeah, FD owners, dude. I love them, they love me.
Perfect.
Match made in heaven for sure. But yeah, so vapor honing, building anything I can get my hands on, not even like stuck to vintage, because RX-8 is not vintage, but anything I can get my hands on for a cheap enough price.
that's the key to like really going. You don't want to,
for sure,
I want to blow the wallet on one build.
Mm-mm. Yeah, I mean, I end up doing it because then I start like trying to be perfect, you know what I mean? And then yeah, but at least the entry price is low. So but yeah, build the influence, reach as many people as possible, and we are mainly trying to keep it in Tampa Bay right now. For those, I don't know if we say it before.
Yeah, I don't think we said it. Tampa Bay. 813.
Yeah, the 813 for sure. Trying to reach as many people in the 813 area as possible. And I mean, we'll kind of spread out, maybe Bradenton, old Cleet Dog. But
no, Cleet.
A little, eh.
Cleetus McFarland, you know. Just
something like.
Might take a trip out to the Freedom Factory.
Yeah. But yeah, try to see as many people in the Tampa Bay as possible and like get as many stores as possible. Not necessarily just car related, motorsports related in general. Just anything possible. You know what I mean? Everybody wants to tell their story and everyone kind of gets stuck on the exotics and Lamborghini and Porsche. And while those cars are cool, and amazing in their own right, it's not an everyday car that right. like everyone can afford. You know what I mean? Somebody might just be able to afford a Civic, which is nothing wrong with a Civic, but you can build a Civic pretty nice. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? And that person isn't really getting to tell his story. You know what I mean? He's just pretty much building it in his garage and talking to his little tribe of people.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Speaking of Hondas, hopefully this person in the St. Pete area, I think it is, Pinellas County somewhere, all-wheel drive monster Hondas. He just converts them.
That's pretty sick.
And they're insane. So hopefully we can get a interview with them because I want to know more.
Yeah.
Speaking of Hondas.
Ooh, and all-wheel drive. I know someone in that area too that has a shop that does a lot of DSM stuff and all-wheel drive stuff. So, yep. So, yeah, we'll definitely be around here if you're local, trying to show support to the local area that's supporting us first before we go anywhere else. So,
absolutely. Yeah. There's a lot of Tampa has a really, really big car culture. And I just think it'd be nice to showcase some of that while it's out there. I don't think people are doing it justice as well as it could be. But there's some influence out here. I've been out here forever, and the old days of before I could even have my license, going on TampaRacing.com and looking at the classifieds, looking at old school cars that people were giving away, going to meets. This place has a lot of car culture, so it'd be cool to highlight it.
For sure. And I haven't been
and
here.
And bike. And bike.
I haven't been here as long as you have, but like the time that I've been here, it's definitely been a lot of stuff. Like, there's a group that I'm in, or a group chat that I'm in, and like every weekend or like every other day damn near, there's like something going on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how do y'all have so much gas and so much free time?
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, there's something.
There's a group I follow on Insta, and it's like every other day they're posting a poster for, meet up at, you know, this gas station here, we're meeting up at this place to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And it's they go deep, and all these people have nice cars, and I'm like, man, how do you have time for anything? You're out every night.
Every night, bro. Every night.
I mean, that's what it's about. That's where you want to be, I guess. Build the car to use it, you know.
Yeah, you gotta show it off.
Which, you know,
that was my problem for the longest. Like, I'd build stuff and then just like sell it. Mm-hmm. And then I sold a couple builds to a few people, and they took credit for it. And I was like, maybe I should let people know that I actually did this.
Yeah. I mean, nothing wrong with making your money and everything, but at the same time, I think building a reputation so you can keep making that money, that's pretty much where I'm trying to be, because I'd love for, you know, this kind of stuff to be my daily job, you know?
Yeah. Same here.
So, flipping cars or do whatever. So, yeah.
I'm a little locked in, but for sure.
Yeah.
This is the goal. This is the goal.
Sir.
We went over that between the both of us. So if you had 10 grand and you could buy one build or do one build, and it could be a motorcycle or a car, what would you spend that 10K on?
For me, I've really been trying to go into drifting lately. So I would try to do something drift worthy. Nothing too crazy. I'd probably spend more money on certain mods. I can't figure out a chassis. I know we kind of prepped and you asked me like a little bit before we started, but I can't think of a chassis. I think if I was to do it, I'd probably go IS300.
I've had two of those. I love them.
They're fun. They're fun. And if I didn't want to do too much work, I'd probably go the wagon, just because I love wagons. So I'd probably do the
Sport Cross or just a wagon.
Just the 300 IS300 wagon.
Sport Cross.
Yeah. I would do that. It already has a 1J in it, most likely. If, you know, no one's touched it. That's a pretty good start of power right there. Weld a diff. I'd probably put some buckets in it so I'm not sliding around in my seat. And some good tires, wheels. maybe turbo upgrade. I should have enough money for that with 10K. Mm. And a tune? Probably that. I'd probably go with the IS300.
That's solid. Very solid.
Maybe that or an SC, because I would love an SC also. And if I do the 400, it comes with the 1UZ.
Yeah.
That's the VA, and that's a little bit more.
People sleep on those. People sleep on those. Big dog eats, though. Mm-hmm. Once you wake it up, at least. There's a, what's his name, Gingium on YouTube. He put a supercharger on it from, I think it's like a Ford something. I can't remember. But he's got a drift truck. And, yeah, 1UZ.
Yeah, he just revamped it up a couple months ago.
Yeah,
and like restructured everything, so it's gonna be nice. But there's also Night Ride. If you watch Night Ride, they built a Skyline R33, I think, or a 4, and they put a 1UZ with individual throttle bodies. Just thinking, oh my, that thing sounds so mean, so mean.
So, for me,
what's your build? 10K.
That's tough, because it's like, do I build something that I've already, a chassis that I've already built before, or is this just like never touched before? That's the question. Like, which one should it be? But then what I can kind of answer.
What are you going to do with it, though? That's always my thing. What's the intention for the build? Is it just to build, or is it, do you want to auto? I know you said you wanted to autocross in the past.
Yeah, which... whatever this new car may be might be the answer.
Yes, sir.
And I ain't going to say the price on this new car. Get myself in trouble. But I would say for the 10K build, most of the time I don't have like an intent. It's just kind of like I like the chassis more than anything, or like the way the body looks more than anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I would probably...
doing it for the love of the build.
Yeah. I'd probably do another 300ZX, because now I know the sauce.
Mm-hmm.
I know the recipe to get 450-ish.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I'd probably do another 300ZX.
You can probably find one for a good price nowadays, too.
Yeah.
But I saw the pictures of the last one you did. Didn't get to see that one in person, but I see the little model you made.
Oh yeah, my boy Russ did that crump, which we'll hopefully get to have him before he may be going somewhere. So,
well, hopefully we can get him on a show.
Yeah.
Because I want to definitely talk to him. He makes models of people's cars.
Yeah,
like what scale is that? Like one.
Don't get me lying. I hate math.
I don't know.
It's nice.
It's super nice. Yeah,
and his attention to detail is wild. Like, he was like, "Let me get pictures of this. Let me get pictures of that." Like, he had the steering wheel and had a Nismo horn button, like an old logo horn button. He made sure he got that.
Mm-hmm.
Had HKS exhaust. He made sure. I was like, "Bro, no one's gonna see underneath the car." He made sure he got the HKS exhaust.
Yeah. I'm looking at it now. Yeah. You can't see it. It's literally in a glass case.
Yeah.
I can't see that exhaust for anything.
Exactly. But it's there. Like, the license plate has the license plate on there and everything. Like, yeah, his attention to detail is nuts.
Yeah.
So, but I would say if I couldn't, because 300ZX, some people charge like stupid money for them. It's smarter to get it with a TT in it. And that might blow the budget now that I'm thinking about it.
Instead of doing it yourself.
Yeah. So my other option would probably be, I'd probably do another Miata.
Okay.
And that one, my last one was boosted, but I'd probably do an ITB one because I haven't done that yet. And just full KG Works stuff, which is like rare parts to find.
NA or NB? I know people are wondering.
So my booster one was NA.
Mm-hmm.
My the one I had before that was an NB on Work Equip 01s, which I found that those are the perfect wheel if you can find it in the perfect spec. I'd probably do another NA one. I think NA is the superior chassis.
I love the way that one looks over the NB.
Oh yeah. And Embiid looks good. And I think I originally liked that the most until I got my NA. And I was like, yo, I love this thing. Like, it already, with liking vintage stuff, it already, when you do, like I did crank windows, or I had crank windows, and I used LRB. They're actually in St. Pete. I don't know if you know about them. Mm-mm. But they make, like, panels and stuff like that. And, like, aluminum panel or radiator panels.
Those are, like, sheet and, work. Like, sheet metal work?
Yeah.
Okay.
But they're, like, they're precise for sure. So, yeah, I had LRB door panels. Like I said, KG work stuff. And then everything just looked... I had a Cobra shifter, like a
Mustang, like bezel. Cobra.
Yeah, like the old one, the accordion style rubber boot and everything. I think I have a picture. I'll try to put it up. But yeah, like everything on that was pretty much vintage looking, and the NA wears it well. So I'd probably do another NA and then do ITBs on it, and just have fun.
Yeah, if you could tune it right, I love the way ITBs sound.
For sure. And I'd probably build the head so that way it can just rev out.
Just sit on leather.
Ass off. Yeah. Revving up that high with ITBs, like.
Saucy.
Yeah. So that's probably what I'd spend the $10K on.
All right.
Z. So if you had, on the other side of that, if you had fuck you money, it was just like, I can just drop this on whatever. But the catch is it can only be one vehicle. What would you spend it on, and what would you do?
I think I would go with a Mercedes 190 Evo. It was like the old 80s, 90s, really boxy Evo. Not Evo. It's called an Evo, but it's a Mercedes.
Yeah.
And that thing, it's probably one of my favorite, like, old school looking cars. But that's just one. I can't pick one. But if I had fuck you money, I'd probably get that one first out of all the fuck you money cars, just because they're harder to find. And I just like the old school boxy look.
Yeah.
So I think I would go to the 190 Evo.
So, ironically, I had a 190E in high school.
What? Not the Evo, though.
Oh, nah, I couldn't afford that.
It was going to say.
Barn find 190E. And, that thing had I remember why I was in a barn. It had a blown head gasket. And the couple that sold it to me didn't tell me that. And so, yeah, it was like cool because I was in high school, this kid in the projects or whatever. I go to high school in the Mercedes and they're like, yo, what is this kid doing? It's like, nah, I could literally just go from home to the projects, or like house or school to the projects, or from my house to work or whatever. Luckily, I was in a small town. So, like, I didn't go anywhere far, but I'd always see smoke coming out from the hood. And I was like, ah. The best part was I owned it in the winter. So it wasn't like really ever hot.
Yeah, it wasn't overheating. Yeah, you could keep it cool.
Yeah. But yeah, come springtime, I let that thing go. And I felt bad for the guy that bought it, because like at the I know now that it was a head gasket. But at the time, I had no idea, because I was just burning through cars or whatever. And so the guy, like, bought it and then drove, I don't know, maybe an hour away. And it, like, it went bad. It was really bad. And I had already, like, sold it, and I bought my Mark III Supra. Like, as soon as I sold it to him, I literally got picked up from the people that I bought the Supra from. And I was like, I can't give you any money back. I've already spent. He's like, I'm gonna sue you. But the one thing I always have done is did like a bill of sale and say, this is as is, where is, And I was like, I mean, you can't really sue me. The little I know about the law is this is legally binding. And I had no idea that it was a head gasket. You know what I mean? I don't know. I'm pretty sure that car got crushed or something. I don't know. But I want to say I sold it for like, I don't know, maybe $2,000 or something like that. So, but yeah, 190. I love that car. Besides
head gasket.
Besides, and I was like, bro, I have no way to like pay for this. I think when I bought, I was just like, I'm out of a Benz.
Especially at a young age. As a young age.
Oh, yeah.
And I know you're school? A hip hop head, so I know everybody's rapping about him. I was like,
oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I thought I was it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that car wasn't it.
So, high school, you're already doing projects. What was your first project car? And how long ago was it? Now that you're looking back, I can see the years rolling back in your head.
Well, first project car, I'd say was a 94. That's kind of tough because there was a lot of cars that I bought that I had intentions to do stuff on that I never really got the money or chance to do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the one thing I did do to everything was subs. That was like, I was a big sub kid, man. I was installing subs for cash and stuff like that.
Same.
And like, I would go like, the bigger the better. Like, I'd always have a 15 for no reason at all. Always have a 15.
In high school, I had two 15s under my bed in my in my house because I was doing it so much. But I just had speakers everywhere. Same. So I just installed them onto my home speakers.
Mm-hmm.
And I literally, every car I got, no matter what, I'd put subs into.
Yeah.
I worked at an audio and tint shop without really working there. I would just show up every day until they like started making me do work.
That's dope. I wish I had that. But yeah, like I either had a 15 or two 12s. Nowadays, my Chaser has a 12 in it, but I learned about quality subs and I had bought a Jetta that had a 8W7 in it, and I learned that like I said, the quality sub and the amp.
The amp like, always.
Yeah, and it had like an old school Pioneer amp, and like that combination was perfect.
I mean, like, once you get to the W's, like the W7s, the W, what is it, 5s?
Yeah, and I had no idea what it was. It came with the car.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily, the guy who I bought the car from, David, appreciate you, homie, Speedworks up in North Carolina. He had like built it for his girlfriend, now wife, or like they had built it together or something like that. And yeah, she just wanted to get rid of it. That car had like over 200,000 miles on it on a Volkswagen. Like the only issue that thing ever gave me was an AC compressor. And I told him about it, and he was like, all right, whenever you come back up here, I'll just replace it for you. That's the only issue I ever had with that car. Took care of it, and I want to say when I traded it in, it had like close to 300,000 miles on it. Still no issue. And it was like on coilovers, TSW wheels, all like, it wasn't just a regular Jetta. I mean, it was, but everyone that I would let drive it or whatever, they'd be like, this is amazing. Like, I'd buy it from you if I didn't see the mileage. But
to over 200, people get skeptical.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But first project car.
Yeah, what was like the first one you actually like dug into and fucked some shit up because you didn't know what you were doing?
I would say that Supra then.
That 94?
It was 87. It was 87.
Not the 94, the Mark III.
Yeah, the Mark III. Yeah. The one that kind of screwed that guy. His money on. Yeah. That one was the first car I actually did stuff to. And that was, at the time, I didn't even know they had a turbo variant of the Mark III. Mm-hmm. I just liked pop-up headlights. I liked boxy. I liked wedge front.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, my uncle had one. Mm-hmm. When I was growing up, he had like it was like midnight blue or something like that. And I remembered seeing it, and I was like, yo, that's like my uncle's car. I want another one. And I remember riding in my uncle's car, and like the wheel telescoped in and out and stuff like that. And I was like, this is sick.
Mm-hmm.
Unbeknownst to me, my uncle had a turbo one. So that was why it was so fast.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this NA one was not fast. But target top, I liked. That was pretty cool.
Yeah, targets are hard.
Yeah. So I would say that was the first project car.
Is your uncle the one who got you into cars, or is it just
nah? I'd say my dad. I'd definitely say my dad, because the car that I remember him having, I remember him having Porsches. I remember him having Range Rovers, Land Rovers, all that stuff. But the car I remember the most, and the car that he let me drive or sit on his lap, was the NA Miata.
Okay.
A white NA Miata. And I have been on the hunt for a white NA Miata ever since. But yeah, that was the car that I remember the most, just probably because I actually like got to do stuff with him in it. So yeah,
true.
Yep. What about you?
First build or
First project car.
Yeah, mine was a 92 Integra. I bought it off my homeboy. He had like lowered it, but not really well. I think he just cut the springs and
that was a thing,
Honda boy shit. So I put some coilovers on there. I can't even remember what coilovers I used. They were cheap, and I think it was like Megan Racing coilovers.
They're still cheap.
Yeah. I put a 95 GSR motor in it from a 95 Integra. Pretty much took out my entire interior so I can just keep the... I put an RSX front bucket seat in it. I made a wall, and that was another thing. I was in the audio, but in Tampa, we like it just loud, especially in that time period.
Still do.
Yeah, it was a little... Yeah, depending on what culture you're in, but... I think I had 215s in there in the back, and then in the where the back seat was, I built a wall of Seleniums, which if you know, Seleniums are a guitar speaker that people would put in like donks and stuff out here to just make them scream. So I built a wall of Seleniums in the front or in the back seat where the back seat was, and I built an amp rack and everything to keep everything on there. Blue lights everywhere. It was like a blue. It was like a really nice blue color. Vinyl wrapped the top half black. I had GSR mesh wheels on it, Honda stuff. Polished them up. I bought them super messed up, but I cleaned them up. And then I got this guy to like make up a cheap exhaust for me, and I just heat coat painted it black, and then just went off racing until I blew a rod 2 years later.
2 years to be driving around like that, though. That's not bad.
That was one of my favorite cars. I still have the VIN. I'm going to look for it and get it back one day if it's not crushed.
Yeah.
Don't say it.
Oh, man.
But yeah, that was like the first one that I actually dug into and broke stuff and was always at the junkyard for. And yeah, technical difficulties. But yeah,
you blew a rod.
I blew a rod, windowed it. but yeah, that was the car that really got me into street racing, and then really took me out of street racing because I almost died so many times. But I had a lot of fun. Every other car was just like a clean build ever since then.
Nice.
I got an Accord wagon and put a bunch of speakers in the back and slammed it and stuff like that. But as far as who got me in, I would say my dad too. He was an RX-7 guy back in the day and a Corolla guy. Street racing in Chicago, that was a whole different beast. He would take us and we'd go to the Puerto Rican Day Parade in Humboldt Park. And if anybody's ever been there, you'll know, especially in that time period, that was wild. And the parades would just be... everybody who had a build would just come out there, and that was like my favorite time of year, because I would be in the parade with my dad in something like a Jeep or something, and just see so many motorcycles and cars that people built and Puerto Rican flags all over the place. But that was it. And I guess my cousin too, because my cousin got a settlement and he just blew it all on an Impala SS, the 94-ish, that style.
Oh, the bubble?
I forgot what they called it, but that was like the first time I actually saw like someone I knew had like a fully custom. He had rims, he had a chameleon paint job. He went in on that. He had literal screens in there in the 90s. No one had that.
Oh, yeah.
So I think that's when it really turned me on.
But. So what would you say, because I have one, but what would you say was your like biggest or craziest build? Like, what the fuck was I thinking? Or I don't care.
I think it was the Integra, just because I did so much to it. Like, I touched every single piece of that car. And every other car since then has just been minor mods here and there. And I haven't gone crazy ever since then. Like I said, it kind of took me out of street racing because I almost died so many times. I almost went on head on with a semi, and that was the last time.
Going on the other side of the road like Fast and Furious.
Yeah. So everything else.
Robbing for VCRs.
So everything else was just like riding around with my friends. And, you know, I was racing on the highway one last time and poop. Right out the hood.
My craziest build was I had a 94 Camry. And I put
a Camry.
I put like all terrain tires on. I lifted it too. And that thing had 215s in the back.
A lifted mud tire Camry.
Yeah, it was the dumbest build ever. I don't even know why I did it.
That's funny to me. I think if I had fucking money, other than just buying one car, I'd probably do a bunch of those. Just silly.
Yeah, it was like, it was retarded. Like, I don't know why I did it. I think whenever I got it, it had wrong suspension on it or something like that. And when I was in high school, I was in auto hobby shop, and there was a lot of times where we would like do stuff for people. Now that I think about it, it was definitely child labor. Stuff. Yeah,
child labor.
Well, we was doing like brakes, suspension, coolant, flush, like all that stuff.
Didn't see a dime.
Didn't see a nickel from any of that work, man. But I guess experience. Oh man, what do you say? But yeah, there was like some throwouts of some suspension or whatever, and I was like, I think that'll work. Because it fits does not mean you should use it. definitely does not mean you should use it.
That's a lesson. The more you know.
Yeah, exactly. The more you know. Wow. But yeah, I don't know what the suspension came off of, but it fit on the Camry, and then. So let me come back. I'm from Atlanta, but I moved to Tennessee, East Tennessee, small town in Tennessee, like my junior year. So hence why I end up with a off-road tire Camry.
That's some southern shit.
A lot of people in the shop, I was like, I bet you'll do it. I was just like, who will do it? Will it fit? Yeah, it'll fit. And so, yeah. I put it on. I couldn't turn, like, I couldn't full turn left or right. I pretty much could just go straight. That was the dumbest thing. But because it snowed, it was, like, perfect.
Yeah,
it was perfect. I essentially took a vehicle that is meant for good fuel economy and stuff like that and just made it the opposite.
The complete opposite.
That was probably the dumbest build I've ever had. What's one that you spent the most money on? If you want to say how much money you spent on it.
Probably that Integra. I literally touched every panel of that. I had a security system on there that through the front windshield glass, it was like stuck up underneath So like when you walk up to it, you can see it, and it's a keypad. You can't feel it because it's just glass, but it's like thermal tested, and I had a passcode to get into the car. And this was
That's OD.
I did so much to this car, man. I mean, every single panel was touched.
It's probably crushed because no one can no one can get into it. They didn't have the passcode. The first time that they locked, it probably was over.
Hey, I give them three extra set of keys for that. So
They might have stood a chance.
I had it literally, and it was like every Honda homologation. I had Prelude side skirts that I fit on there. I literally did so much to that car. And spent so much. I think the junkyard made all their money off of me.
I would say the one I spent the most money on would probably, without, of course, the initial investment of buying the car, would probably be my first Z. Or was that my second?
The 300?
Yeah. My first or second Z32. I think it was my second. Silver one here, and this is where I learned to not trust any shop in Tampa. Mm. I mean, there are shops now that I know to trust. But I don't know.
Gotta be careful out there.
Yeah, exactly.
Read the reviews.
And, yeah, for sure. But I didn't know about the reviews. I didn't look any of this stuff up. And, I mean, I'll go ahead and say, I don't care to name drop this shop specifically because there's pages about him.
I mean,
but Z Fever, that dude, Doug, was a crook, man, straight crook. And, it sucks because, most people that watch Adam LZ in his, I guess you could say, early days, he used
his early car days. Yeah.
Yeah. He used, 240 days. He used Martin from RS Enthalpy.
Mm-hmm.
And for people that don't know, Martin is here. He's here. He's like the next city over, technically Riverview area.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, he's very accessible too. Mm-hmm. And, he tunes at Z Fever. So a lot of people associate him with Z Fever,
but he's
he's not, you know what I mean? And like, so whenever Z Fever was screwing me over, like I was apprehensive to Martin, and mm-hmm. Martin had to, like, you know, tell me and stuff like that. And when I dropped my ECU to get the Niztune board put in at his house, that's when I realized, like, oh, okay, these are two separate people, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Two separate businesses and entities. It's just, he probably gets like a super cheap discount counted rate on dyno rental or something like that.
Yep.
But yeah, Martin's a great tuner.
Martin's one of the best out here, honestly. Yeah. I hear so many stories and so many people tuned by him.
Yeah, especially Nissan stuff.
Especially Nissan. Between Infinity. Him and dude at Pencil Tuning.
Oh yeah, Pencil Tuning, he's pretty dope too. I've talked to him, I haven't got to meet him.
Mm-hmm.
But I've met like Troy Court, he's the other Jamaican.
Yeah.
Pencil Tuning Jamaican. Troy's pretty dope too. But yeah, so that I would say that Z, and not even, I guess I bought the car at night, and someone offered, I think the dude had like 40, he put it up for 4,500 and made it seem like it was an original TT. It wasn't. It was an NA chassis with a TT swap in it with like eBay turbos on it, smoking the high hell, whatever. It had good parts on it, but it wasn't good.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had it up for 4,500 and I guess people were like blowing him up for it. And on that same day, I had sold that, or right before that, I had sold the NB Miata that had the work equips on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in, what is that city? It's like little Puerto Rico.
I mean, Florida?
Kissimmee.
All right.
Yeah. Went to Kissimmee.
Definitely
to little look Puerto Rico. Exactly.
You want to find an RX-7? A Honda?
Yeah, go to Kissimmee. But yeah, I went there and I was actually looking because I have like an affinity for JDM front end swapped Integras.
Mm.
And someone had one there, but it was like a Bondo Bandit. Like, I was like, man, this thing's amazing. He was like, yeah, but it doesn't have exhaust. I was like, whatever, you know, I might drive it back. not realizing, like, Kissimmee's far. That's the first time I drove out there. I was like, dang, this is far. Like, I never had an hour feel like more than an hour.
It's the traffic, man. It's the traffic.
Yeah. So while we were driving it around, I went with a buddy of mine that he had a Civic Type R when it was, like, new. And we got there, and I was just like, okay, it looks good in a garage with, like, no lighting. You pull it out. And, like, you kind of see, like, hairline cracks and stuff like that. When we drove it, I was like, oh, no, I can't drive. I can't drive this back. And looking around in the rear end and stuff like that. And I was like, man, let me just do a Carfax on it. Did a Carfax. And apparently it was, like, the rear end had just been destroyed. And so, like I said, it was just Bondo everywhere. I was like, man, I can't buy this. And he wanted, like, I think he wanted, like, $5,000 for it. And I had sold the Miata for like $6,000 or $6,500 or something like that. So it's like I had the money for it, but like I don't want to do that. And then we stopped at Zaxby's on the way back, and I had saw it, and I hit the dude up. He's like, "Yeah, someone's coming right now." And I was like, "How much to like hold it or whatever?" And he was like, "If you give me more than what he's gonna give me," I was like, "Well, I don't know what he's gonna give you." And I should have stuck to my guns then and been like, hell no, I'm not buying this thing. That was like the first thing. No. So I was just like, I give you $4,800. And he was like, all right. There probably was no one that was coming to get it.
Just about to say that.
There probably wasn't. But I got home, called the dude up that had went with me to Kissimmee. I was like, yo, meet me here. And this was in Tampa. I think it was like near university or something like that. And I lived in Ruskin. And so I was like, this car's closer to you. Just meet me there. You know what I mean? And he met me there. And it was at night. Looked at it at night. Problem number two, like, what are you doing looking at this car at night? I'm already paying more than what the guy wanted for it. Went at night. And I was just like, oh, man, this thing's amazing. I want a Z so bad. And starts up, starts smoking, it's choking, whatever. But it starts to run all right. And then he, like, takes me for a ride in it. And, like, I just hear clunking in the back. Should have been, like, number three to be like, nah, okay, let me investigate further. But he was like, yeah, you know, just needs diff mounts and da-da-da. I was like, all right, well, it's just Nissan stuff. And we're doing, like, donuts downtown and stuff like that. I'm like, all right, well, it has power. The turbos were, like, way too big for it. And so, yeah, I bought it. My buddy had, I think, his girl with him. So, and he had the Civic Type R, and he had a S2000. So he had drove the S2000. So his girlfriend drove the S2000. He drove the Z back to my house, and yeah, I was like super happy, and then I proceeded to spend like an ungodly amount of money on the car, and I trusted another shop, which is another shady shop, Z-Docs or Zoom Docs or whatever you want to call them. Like I learned so, like I spent the most money on that build, but I learned so much.
That's the thing when you when you really go in on a build, that's when you learn, I think.
Yeah.
That's why I said that sometimes you got to mess it up too to learn.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. Luckily, unluckily, I was deployed during the time, so I had deployment money, which is not a lot, but like when you're in a sandbox, it's a lot. When you're home and you got to pay for like groceries and light bill and this, like I don't have any of those, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
It's just like I might as well. Oh, these new turbos, might as well. Like Z1 Motorsports in Atlanta, like they knew me by name. That's how much stuff I bought. And Concept Z in Arizona, I think they are, same. Like I spent so much money on that on that car, and with that shop, to the point that whenever it was all said and done, I ended up like leaving with the car. I got all the hardware in a cigar box. Like it was there. I was there deployed for 6.5 months. Took like a month and a half of leave on top of that. So all that time, and yeah, he didn't even swap the motor. He didn't put the motor in, nothing.
What?
All he did was take the motor out. I was like, yeah, I took it to the machine shop. They're going to do this. They're going to do that. And apparently one head was decked. The other head wasn't. And one side of the block was decked. The other side wasn't. And like they were swapped. So essentially instant head gasket failure.
I was just about to say. Yeah.
Yeah. And they were
leaking everywhere. Yeah. Probably.
And those were Cometic head gaskets too. Mm. They weren't cheap. I want to say they were like 200 a side. It's like $400 in head gaskets. Yeah, so yeah, fuck that place. But through that I met another shop. It's another Z shop. I know the owner's name is Harry. He's a tuner. He doesn't really do any, he does work, but it's like his own personal stuff. Mm-hmm. His attention to detail is crazy. His Z's are clean. He tunes clean. And whenever I had the Z after that, he tuned that, and that one made like a little over 400. And I spent, even with buying the car, like I want to say I bought the car for like 7 or 8K in Alabama. Mm. And trailered it back in the day. So even with buying the car, paying for the trailer, parts or whatever, I spent way less on that car than I did the other Z, and I actually like got what I was trying to do out of it. So yeah.
So rule number one, don't look at cars at night.
No, don't look at cars at night for sure.
Rule number two, if they say they got another offer on the table,
let them take it.
Let them take it.
Let them take it.
And then rule number three, you hear anything in the back clinking,
Run. Rule number four, don't trust Z-Docs. And don't trust Z-Fever either. They're both scammers. Don't trust them as far as you can throw them.
Hey, Florida's full of scammers.
Yeah.
And
for sure. For sure. But like I said, through that experience, though, like, people see my garage now, they're like, man, you got a full-on shop. It's because of those two fuckheads. That's why I have what I have. I'm not even going to lie to you. Literally because of them. And I got tired. Got burnt out of like, oh, let me take it to this shop. Let me get a truck. Let me borrow a truck. I didn't have a truck at the time. Let me borrow a truck. Let me get a U-Haul trailer. Let me find some people to help me push this car up the trailer. And then get to the shop. And then got to push it off or whatever. Those two people. Like I said, I probably gave them the most amount of money, but I got my lesson out of it for sure.
I'm sure you did.
Yeah.
Hey. And, you know, it's whatever, but it just sucks. It gives people a bad name.
Yeah.
It's hard to trust anybody after that. So, yeah, I can see why you just went head over heels on getting everything you need to do your own work.
And also a good thing. The fact that the Z is like, everyone has it, their like minds made up of how the Z, oh man, that thing is ridiculous because the engine is literally wall to wall. Like, but
tight fit.
Yeah, it's a super tight fit. But they're misunderstood engines too. Like I said, I made like 400 something easy. I didn't rebuild the engine, I didn't rebuild the heads, none of that. It was literally on E85. Nismo, I can't remember what CC injectors they were. I know they're red top. Whoever knows, they're red top. Regasketed everything. They were stock turbos. The old man that I had bought the car from supposedly rebuilt them. I never confirmed whether he did or not because I didn't take them off. Mm-hmm. And then I did the 120 or had. A shop in Fort Myers do the 120K service on it. ORZ did that, and then had exhaust, like 3-inch exhaust. I think that's it for like engine mods. That was really that wasn't it. Bigger intercooler piping. And a selling translator. So, like, I had dual MAFs. Yeah, dual. So it was like a true dual intake, and the cell-in translator essentially translate to make the ECU think that, oh, I'm only using one map. One. When really, you're using two. And bigger intercoolers. Like, but they were like Z1s, like branded bigger intercooler or whatever. Gotcha. And Go Fast Bits, they have I think it's TPMS or TPS response blow off valves, but they can be blow off or recirc or like a blend of whichever, you know, you want to do.
So adjustable and tunable. Yeah, that's cool.
And you can do like harshness, softness, stuff like that. So but other than that, that was it. And I essentially spent the money where I needed to, and I got the result that I wanted for sure. Okay. So,
and that's not really that much work, to be honest, to do those kind of mods.
No. The 120K service, that's timing belt and everything. That thing, that thing's wide. But, I mean, a VQ, no one complains about a VQ, and it's just as wide as a VQ. So, I don't know.
Yeah. That's another motor. People love them or hate them, but, and the people who love them know what they're doing with them. And they can make those things super powerful and reliable.
Yeah. For sure. So, but yeah, like I said, that's my hard head makes a soft ass car for sure. For sure. But I love Z's though. I love Z32s. And it sucks that they cost the amount that they cost. I was even gonna LS swap that Z, the first one, because I was just so pissed that I had like the parts list on that Z, man. Like, I had a new crank. I can't remember who made the crank. New pistons, CP pistons, Eagle rods, ARP everything, main studs or main bolt, or I did a main stud conversion. You know, the thing is like ARP 2000 rod bolts, ARP head studs, Kometic head gasket. Like I said, CP pistons, like that motor was built. That car should have made like close to 1,000. That motor was built, and I sold the car for maybe a couple $100 more than I bought it for. After all of that. Yeah.
That's the thing. That's the name of the game sometimes, especially.
It is,
especially the more custom you go, the more the more stuff that's done to it, that's the price you pay sometimes.
The kid that bought it too, like, he had no idea what he had bought, but he and I had told him like, hey, you know, it's not tuned, like it was on the NIS tune, and it was on a safe tune to like drive around, put around, stuff like that. Not really get, I think I had the boost controller limited to like 10 or 8 PSI, which is like nothing. And but that was what Martin wanted it, so that way I can break in the motor. He was like, don't really put boost into it, you know, put load, but not boost. So, and I think he drove to like Fort Myers and he had an issue because it wasn't broken in yet or anything. And of course, blow by and all that stuff. So, but yeah, and then he sold it to somebody, and someone like found a receipt with like my name and number in it, and that person texted me and was like, does it really have all this stuff? And I was like, will you sell it? Now that I know what I'm doing, I will buy that car, I need it back in a heartbeat, because I know what's in it. You know what I mean? And I doubt that anyone's gonna pull the motor to take all that stuff out. So I hope that no one has a story as bad as mine. I hope for their sakes.
There might be worse. I listened to, was it the Alpha Podcast?
Oh, Street Alpha Podcast.
The Street Alpha Podcast. And Mike was on there. And he said he went through nine SRs before he figured it out. That had to be expensive. That had to be a pain.
Because when he was talking about it, SRs weren't that expensive.
Hey, he said he built a 2J and got it up to 600 horsepower, no problem, with a fraction of the cost.
Yeah. But Which car was that in, though? Was that in the Z?
That was in the SC.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
he did the SC with the 2J.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I know his Z had SR20 in it.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. It is what it is, though.
Like I said, sometimes you got to go through the pain. And now he knows the recipe, and he can build that probably no time, build a reliable one.
In the sleep. And probably got the sponsorships and stuff like that, too.
Hey, anybody looking for sponsors? Looking to sponsor?
Please. I build too much stuff that I don't have sponsorships for. I mean, I'm still going to buy your stuff regardless, but.
Who's your dream sponsor? We got Blue Chew. We got.
Luckily, I'm not at the point where I need Blue Chew yet.
We got the honey. We got. I mean, for automotive, you know, I know you're already sponsored by someone, in a sense, but you're in a different program, but
it's hard to say because a lot of people that are sponsored, like, are building these, like, 4-digit horsepower cars. I don't care for that. Like,
exactly.
I think cars shine the most depending on what they are. I think 450, which people think that's baby numbers. I think that's fun. Like 350 and certain, like the Miata had that was boosted, that made, I want to say like 240 torque is where rods say see ya. So it was like just under that for the torque. The horsepower, I think, was like 230 something or something like that. I know the torque was more than the horsepower. But that thing felt like a rocket.
And that chassis, that thing's flying. Yeah.
Exactly. But someone that's like, oh, yeah, you need 500 or 400. And there were some people that was like, that's baby numbers. Mm-hmm. You know, Car Passing Channel did this. That is great for Greg Peters. That is not great for me. I got things to live for. I'm good.
At that point, it's, on top of that, it's just not reliable. Like, that's a lot of people talk about 1,000 horsepower, but that's really not reliable.
Exactly.
That's what it is. You're going to be rebuilding that or putting in a 600 horsepower motor
exactly
in a few months.
Yeah, billet block and this and that or whatever. Like, that's not fun. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to be able to, if I could or if I needed to, I can build it over the weekend with parts that aren't going to cost like an arm and a leg.
Got to get custom this and
exactly
weight order this because they don't make them that often. Forget all that.
Yeah. So, like I said, 450 in the Z. But it made a little over 400, and that felt great. Mm-hmm. It could have used a little bit more power, but like, I think just changing the turbos would have been the solution because they were stock turbos.
Yeah.
But yeah, a little over 400 is like where I like to be. Some cars, 350 or whatever. My Monte Carlo that might make 350, and I bet that's gonna feel crazy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? In that car, and that car's heavy. You know what I mean? That is a boat.
That is a boat. I love boats.
Yeah. But like, if I made 500, 600, 700 horsepower, where the hell am I using that at? Oh, you use it at drag strip. You think I spent all this money to send this down the strip? You got your damn mind. No, I want to be able to drive it everywhere. You know what I mean? Reliably. And if something happens, I can go to O'Reilly's. Or something like that, Napa, Auto, whatever, the big four, you know what I mean? And I should be able to get something off the shelf. EFI, no. But, like, you know, water pump or something like that.
Yeah,
like,
for sure.
I should be able to get all that from off the shelf and fix it.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, my horsepower goals are pretty low to some people's
standpoint. I think it's pretty reasonable, man.
Yeah.
I mean, it's cool as a, you know, as humanity, like on the engineering aspect, that we can get to those high numbers, 2,000, 2,500 RPM, or not RPM, horsepower. Before what?
Are you going back to the future? Like, what are we doing?
Cool. You're going to be rebuilding, and even if it's for the track, you're going to be rebuilding that motor like every two, three track days. If you build something reliable, 400 or 500 horsepower, you're going to be going to the track all year. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. The people that are like the happiest, it seems like, on track, people in Miatas. The Miata ain't really making much. Or if it's like a LS swap Miata, you know what I mean? That's making 350 to 400, you know, maybe five or whatever. You know, five is kind of like, eh. But I guarantee you it probably didn't cost them too much to do it. You know what I mean? Like the cars that that aren't making crazy horsepower are the ones that seem to be the ones that last. You know what I mean? Like, you're leaving a lot of stuff on the table, yeah, but like, you live to race another day.
Literally.
You know.
And you get more seat time. You get better.
Yeah.
As for sure. Depending on your goals in motorsport, you know.
Yep.
Seat time is where it's at. It's not really.
Oh yeah. Not like, oh, I was able to go around the track like once. Okay. Well, you didn't even make the leaderboard, or you didn't make anything because
you spent 150. DNF. You spent probably 150, 350 to be at that event. And then for what? DNF?
Yep.
That's crazy.
Exactly. But you spent enough to make it reliable.
Mm-hmm.
You might be on that podium because everyone else might be DNF. Or, you know, you just get that seat time. And there could be more time left in the car. Like, yeah, you can slowly start turning things up. But I think anyone with some sort of responsibility or some sort of, like, handling should be able to get in any car that's 350, 400 horsepower and, like, be able to turn some pretty good laps or make a good enough pass. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And be like, I had fun. That's at the end of the day, that's what you want, fun. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, you're there to compete or whatever, but like, you just want to have fun. That's why you're there.
Yeah, that's the majority of people. Yeah. Everybody there watching wants to have fun, wants to see you have fun too, you know. There's a lot that goes with that. But I think a good recipe is just reliable horsepower and add lightness. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
Take away from the car to give it a little bit more.
Yeah, what you don't need.
Mm-hmm.
That can get you, you know, faster times too.
Yeah.
For sure.
You can get pretty damn good. Keep up with people and, you know, depending on how they're set up. I've seen people with 400 horsepower keep up with people with 8 because just the way it is.
It's light.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That power to weight is a big thing. Corner balance, probably. You know what I mean? All that stuff. How you set it up. Like, you can make 8,000 horsepower, but you're on stock springs. You're on stock brakes.
Literally.
What? Okay. Yeah.
And that's another thing. You go to those, you know, four-digit horsepower ranges, you got to change a lot to keep, you know, that.
To sustain.
Yeah. That's a lot of power going throughout the chassis. You got to change quite a few things.
Yeah.
I mean, especially depending the discipline, like, whatever motorsport you're getting into.
Mm-hmm. That's a lot. So yeah, I stay with my baby numbers, but I stay happy.
Stay with that smile.
Yeah, exactly. At the end, like I said, that's what you're there for. So, but that's been a good conversation with you today,
sir.
Like I said, it's your boy PA
Manny,
and this is Cafe Moto. Look out for more episodes, and hopefully we can link up with some people.
Yeah, I'm excited for that, and hopefully get a little bit better. This first episode, everybody's first episode's a little whatever. So I'm sure we'll get better too. And
yeah,
I'm more excited to hear these people's stories and
see
what the community has to offer.
Yeah, see if anyone else has a story that tops my
I'm waiting.
Like I said, I hope there isn't, but.
I want to hear another. I want to hear somebody else who put as many Honda parts on a Honda as I did.
That'd be sick.
Homologation of all the Hondas.
Yeah.
But
all right. See y'all. Take it easy. Peace.
Peace.